Radio 1's Hackney Weekend, this weekend.
More comedy from Russell Howard here on BBC HD from 12:30. For now, though, very strong language and a view past the mud of Glastonbury.
When the shows come to an end on the pyramid stage, a pilgrimage of 100,000 people winds its way uphill through the rain and mud to a far corner of the festival, and another Glastonbury begins.
From the glass coffin of genre, a startling new song breaks forth. Like a defiant Methuselah mouse gnawing through the cadence of mythology and coming up in Rockefeller Plaza to see the statue of Prometheus look down. Two gypsy children dead upon the shore, and the cable snaps in a riotous carnival erupting on the Utopia bypass. The cavalcade of doom and dirty deals grinds to a halt while the revelers storm across the frontier chanting, Viva la Musica.
Anyone could put on U2 or Beyonce or Coldplay. I mean, that's not clever, is it? All the inventive stuff that we do, like the Traveller's Fields, you're down in Southeast Corner, that's the new stuff we're doing. It's so mind-blowing and it's so inventive. It's just pushing the boundaries of performance, isn't it?
Visions of the future. Sometimes visions of an ideal future, sometimes visions of a sort of nightmare future. Without utopia, we would be nowhere. Without that idea of us moving on.
Manchild, look at the state you're in. Manchild.
My nickname for the farm is actually Shangri-La. In a valley full of romance and of beauty and of fun, away from the harsh realities of the real world. When they come back from anywhere, they say we're back in Shangri-La again. It's a romantic sort of concept of living in pure pleasure and fantasy.
The early paradises are islands that appear from the mists once every 7 years, and if you can actually get there, then your life will be blissful forever. For a weekend or a week, that's Glastonbury for people.
This could be heaven or hell, depending on your perspective. I believe that it is our chance to be free and to look after each other. For you to
just got all the extremes here, you know. It's got to, it's humanity all coming together and seeing what happens.
When people come here, they forget their daily worries, the mundane sort of reality, and they can become, for a few days, just completely free, where they can do what they like and act how they like. They haven't got to worry about the sort of constraints of every day. You can just be who you want to be at Glastonbury.
People feel free, people feel relaxed. It's in our genes almost, midsummer, get together with your friends outside and enjoy yourselves.
Welcome. Me llamo Tomayo Rosellón. Estoy muy contento de estar aquí. Estoy de Mallorca y yo quiero hablar con la gente de Glastonbury a ver cómo piensa todo, ¿no? This man is typical of Glastonbury, man. Fantastic. And Glastonbury, this fantastic festival.
My
first time in my life come to Glastonbury. Fantastic. I had little sleep and a lot of amusement. Yes.
Yeah,
fantastic. Sleep. For you, what is Glastonbury about, in a nutshell?
It is getting away from the society outside.
See?
And living away from all of these.
Getting away from the pressure.
Getting away from the issues.
Yeah.
Stop us from being
who we are. It's like a little city here.
Yeah.
A broken city. That looks like a reflection, is how the world's gonna get in a minute if we don't, not careful. Like a lost paradise.
Thank you.
into a, I think, a very English surrealism. Carnival, fairground, Festival of Fools, going back to a sort of rural idyll to somehow find a native British art. Utopia has that thread running through it.
Oh my God, look at that. What the hell is here? This is crazy. This is like Disneyland, but crazy.
Often people are really fascinated, like, what is this all about? What the hell are you doing? Stopping and asking you, like, why? Why have you turned a beetle car into a frog? And it's great, that bewilderment. You do get some people who are scared. Some people think it's scary. You know, it's muddy, it's full of old punks, and, you know, we all look a bit rough, and we've been here for weeks, and we're muddy and smelly, and there's these giant monsters everywhere, and there are people that think it's a bit scary.
We're just this little vision of possibilities, you know, and it's a happy world. It's not a sad world. It's not a world where people are in terror. This is a world where people are in enthusiasm and creation. And once you've seen it, you can't unlearn it. You can't never know that this doesn't exist again. Children see it, and they go, oh, this is what I want to do when I grow up.
This place is crazy.
Oh, yeah, it's mad, is it?
It looks like a broken place or something, but it's funky. I think this place comes alive at night time.
At night, yeah.
It's a nighttime place.
You're coming tonight. You're doing the fire show.
Wow.
I sleep in the helicopter. That's my bedroom. Me and my girl living there. Visually, it's great, but it's the worst sound clash in the world because got Bez's Acid House stage playing into it that way. And Sharky's Church of the Holy Roller playing into it that way. And it's just a massive sound clash inside it. You know, I like parties, and the more noise that's going on and people and the happiness, the better I sleep, you know.
Most people are not aware that the festival really started in 1914, just before the First World War, with this guy who was a classical composer. He was an early socialist, a member of the Communist Party, but looked like a hippie. And he wrote what is still the longest-running opera in the West End of London, based on the Arthurian romance, The Immortal Hour. It's a sort of concept album before its time. It's become another one of the legends of Glastonbury, almost. The sort of assembly halls have sort of been recolonised by the sort of new generation.
Oh, hello.
Get me in the mood.
Oh, hello, get in the mood for what?
Glastonbury, I watched you in a film.
The first time I actually worked here for Michael Evers, I had to cover this place where the articulated lorries turned, and it was raining like this, basically, at the time. It had just started, and he drove up, and I said, what about this shelter then, Michael? And I said, why? I said, well, you know, to shelter people from the rain. And he said, it won't rain. It was raining, but he said it was so much authority that I believe him. It's true. It stopped raining 5 minutes later, didn't rain again at all. And I thought, this is a rather strange person. A man of some potency. The way he kept a straight face, you know, without a touch of irony. It's not going to rain.
Hello, how are you
nice
doing?
To meet you. Thank you for the festival.
Nice to see you.
People sort of love to see me and stop me and to talk to me, kind of your photograph and all that sort of thing.
Lovely, excellent. Oh, lovely.
People seem to like to be able to sort of attach it to a person, don't they? Who's actually doing all this? I can't say I don't like it, because I do like it. But it's something that I'm really sort of proud of. But it is a bit overpowering, though.
Thank you very much.
I likened it to a Tudor monarchy. It has a star chamber of main men under him. The power just sort of went down, but always, you know, ultimate power was with the king, King Michael. It's an extremely authoritarian regime, really, you know, and becoming more so all the time. as we, you know, succeed to more and more, as they call it, health and safety, but let's call it insurance industry motivated regulation.
Shangri-La is this idea of a valley in the mountains. It's this hidden paradise on Earth that somehow has survived for centuries. People are wandering from the fields to these strange environments that they find. You don't know what's around the next corner.
Expressing the fear of the society that we're living in and how it's going to go. How we can be if we don't sort it out. People's fears built large. Visions of the future.
The people who joined communes in the 60s and early 70s could not afford to buy the place in the country and went travelling, became the travellers. They were the same people, the same section of society. When punk broke in the late 1970s, you got this sort of almost rejection of the hippie dream and this sort of hard anger against what was happening, the cuts that were coming in at that time. A very urban phenomenon. I'm on the road again. Out of that, you get this harder culture. My special friend. You know, the first time I traveled
out in the rain and snow, in the rain and snow. A lot of the punks were shifting out into the last bits of the convoy, wasn't it? It was the late 70s and the early 80s, and that's where everyone was kind of going. Crazy Anarchy was moving into the convoy and the sure. traveling community. And that was where the two elements met.
This sort of combination of punk and hippie, the so-called peace convoy, which becomes this sort of almost travelling village, which everybody is worried about descending on them.
We came here the year that Margaret Thatcher smashed the peace convoy at Stonehenge.
1985.
There was nowhere to go, so we decided to come here.
From that day on, you know, Stonehenge didn't exist anymore as a traveller's event. So it was agreed that they would come in at 2 o'clock in the morning at the 8:37. There's a huge convoy. 200 vehicles turn up. I gave them a space and we gave them food and stuff and we gave them blankets and things. It was kind of refugee status for those people, really.
We arrived in this big old skull bus, a broken bus we made into a giant skull with a rib cage.
They made it into something that expressed the traveller thing, you know, the freedom, anarchy, the wish to be free.
These people are incredibly creative, and I think that's very much comes from, like, the DIY culture. You know, you live on the road, you meet other people, and you learned really, really hardcore skills.
This is
amazing.
Yeah.
What's the origin of the face, though?
Easter Island, isn't it?
Easter Island. They're rare.
They'll come up with the most amazing things, you know, with a welding rod and their gas burners. They did moving vehicles then, too, on site. Did it really, really graphic. But they were metalheads, really.
There used to be these amazing kind of metal-bashing jams on cars, and, you know, they used to build dinosaurs out of tractors and car henge and things like that.
People go, I saw that Stonehenge out of cars you built. Changed my life.
There was quite a scary atmosphere in places, which was a lot of fun. It was quite dark and a real wildness. This area definitely still has that, and I think it's because a lot of the people who were there in those days are still kind of here doing this.
You can see this sort of communes movement starting to come out at the end of the war, with a real thread of peace activism built into it, which runs into the very early CND and the Oldham Aston March itself. And you've also got that link to music. You've got this whole jazz culture in the beginning, which then turns into a sort of radical folk music. You could see those very early Oldham Aston marches as sort of festivals on the move. They were parties.
Everyone likes a party. No matter where you are, just go and have a party with people and everyone understands it. It's our greatest export, really.
Emancipate yourselves from mental slavery. None but ourselves can free our minds.
I'm a free spirit. But to do what I want to do with my life, and no one's going to tell me that hey, you can't do that because we don't like it. One of my ancestors was sent to Australia as a torpedo martyr. He was fighting for agricultural wages, you know, for farm workers. He was campaigning and burning things. He was a troublemaker, yeah. He'd be proud of me, wouldn't he? I hope so. I think so.
So won't you help to sing these songs of freedom? 'Cause all I ever had, redemption songs.
Now, I just want to talk about the criminal justice act that we have in England. In a way, it's the biggest favour, because they tried to repress us, but it drove the underground together. The bikers, the anarchists, the travellers, the techno tribes, the computer kids, the old school, the hard school, were driving it together.
You get key crossover people in sort of utopian thought, people who take the ideas from one generation to another. Clearly, Joe Strummer was one of those. I mean, he's got a little bit of Glastonbury all to himself now.
First show of the night here at Strummerville. You give a big, warm welcome to Nara Sinato.
He linked the whole hippie ideology, that whole sort of ethos of sitting around campfires, talking through your ideas, thinking through the future, looking forward, and building on all those different cultural reference points.
There's a bonfire here all through the night, and I'll be here at about 3 a.m.
See you there.
That same year, as people took the fence down and people drove in up there, create this really whole post the railway line late night thing. Temporary reality of licensing didn't quite exist, so people could do what they naturally are meant to do, which is party all night in the middle of a field around midsummer. press used to call everyone who went to Glastonbury, you know, crust, these mudlarks. All you'd see was pictures of people covered in mud. I think really it was Roy who really pushed this idea that actually we're all going to wear suits.
Roy, you made it in the end.
How are you?
He's looking very, very smart. A typical traveller, like he's been dressed up posh like this. Roy, can you show us what's in there?
I remember Roy from the old days, he used to go, oh, he ran the best bar. He had a little bar, and then suddenly he had this huge thing called Las Vegas.
Las Vegas, it was a bit of a joke, really. We just come up with an idea for a James Bond movie in a casino.
People would dress up in ball gowns. You could kind of hire costumes and go in and go into a casino, and you had to be smart.
People put on something pretty fantastic. You built something and then it exploded, and every single creative person that was involved with that ended up getting their own little bit of this land.
All of those then grew. So like then Arcadia has now got its own vast area. Block 9, which is, has got its own vast area, which is the New York Download. So it's like seeds really, each one goes off and develops in its own way.
In the old days of Glastonbury, one did not need to get all this crazy bands, you just jump over the fence. Yeah. This is true, no?
It's very true.
Now it's not possible.
No, it's difficult. It's very difficult unless you have a grappling hook.
Tengo grappling hook.
Yeah, you've got one.
Tengo in my rucksack.
It started off as essentially a free festival. We have something very special here. We're going to protect ourselves, which is sort of double-edged. I think Thomas More would recognise this place, no problem. It's not just the medieval mud and the sort of medieval carnival, but I think he would recognise the walled city. People streaming in through gates, being checked by guards. That is the double edge of utopia, dystopia.
Glastonbury is a little walled city inside England, and this is a little walled city inside Glastonbury. It's like Berlin within the Berlin Wall. It's like a little pocket of freedom.
I've always based myself over this side. There's still the sense that some of the people here are in the same pair of underpants they arrived in. The rest of it has a very polished and washed feel to it.
I walked the entire length of the site last night as I came in, and you get a very different feel for the first sort of two-thirds of the site, almost feeling that people are going to try and stop me and sell things.
You pay to get in and you have to have a wristband to go to that bar or hear that sound system, and everything's got corporate sponsorship all over it plastered. Like, this isn't like that. It is up there if you want to go up to Babylon.
I got friends in various different areas all over the site, but mainly we've all graduated up to the green fields because it's just getting worse and worse down there.
Shangri-La, Arcadia, the Common, we don't see any corporate sponsorship.
I could have Babylon every day of my life, you know what I mean? Money and crowds, I don't want that, you know? I don't want to be down there.
The Babylon. Basically, there's a lot of consumerism. I'm not particularly into that. But, you know, the main stage, it's an incredible experience when you go down there. I think that's really important.
I don't go over there unless it's fucking Stevie Wonder or Prince.
The spider's coming now. It's coming now. The fire rising out of the ground to come out and take over the people. It's gonna burn them out.
Work in itself to look at, but then you've got all the performance art as well, and then you've got bands and DJs playing the whole thing. It's you know, it's a wonderful combination of all the things that have kind of built up over the 20 years of the whole kind of rave and dance music movement.
Fire is the birth of human civilization. This is when it all started, happened, that we became a bit different than the animals.
Fire is something what gives me energy. I feel happiness, I feel that it's the energy for the life.
Fire.
When I have not much energy, I go in the flames.
I think all people have fire in their life.
Fire is the starting point, and it also will be the ending point. The city is fire, all the engines are fire, the bombs are fire, the war, all is burning. This is through our civilization from the beginning to the end. We are living the fire life.
All right, gorgeous, here we are with the download.
This is where the real people hang out. Hookers, lookers, trannies and fuckers, come on down.
We're all part of like the tranny free community. We're all free expressionists. There's no rules to speak of at all.
Yo, this is our paradise, this is our secret savior.
I'm now outside the gay disco because I'm passionate about arse action. There's a regiment of us on a mission.
Hold the line. No more air.
Make some noise if you think I look amazing in the neck curtain. Fabulous, isn't it? Ladies and gentlemen, make some noise for Ingenue St. John!
Bonjour.
Are you ready, NYC down low? You wanna raise your right hand in the air.
Gonna tell you stories, sausage boy. Sausage boy, lost his test. Let's try it with different bread, different sauce, different dip.
We'll be right back.
Pushing my luck all the time. You know, with my neighbours and the village. I'm still taking calls about noise in the night. The lady phoned me and said, look, the noise is terrible. So, well, the limits are agreed with the council. So she said, it's all very well, but my children can't sleep. I said, but how old are your children? 8, 10, and I said, well, in 5 years' time, your children will be here. So think about that. So she put the phone down.
What I'd like to do is build this wonderful soundproofed booth that was a total silent booth amongst all the cacophony of sounds that the festival is. Imagine walking into this world of utter silence and just jungle noise through. You look through this window at this pool and these waterfalls. Beautiful mermaids to sat around on rocks in this magical little place. With mermen as well, and just floating in and out, people looking down in this utterly silent world.
If you have been contaminated, you may experience the following symptoms. Perverted habits of thought. Excessive, pathologic or uncontrollable sexual desire. Eccentricity of character. Singular and absurd habits.
The last vestige of the human race. And I love it. I'm infected. We all are. What are we going to do?
Sense of contamination is naked.
The big glowing green one over there, the source of contamination. The snake has been totally condemned and shut down, but they've ripped open the doors and they're still raving. And they really love the virus because it gives them, like, loose morals and, like, nymphomania and stuff. They're like, bring on the virus.
Act now and report immediately to your dear Shangri-La health officer.
We had to change it into a dystopia because it's just more fun.
Shaven, freshly waxed, if you haven't already. Walk through here, continue on your spiritual journey.
Incredible conversations that happen all over Glastonbury around campfires where people feel really relaxed and open and they feel quite united with everyone around, and it's the only way that you really understand what's going on in your generation at that time is to talk to people around you.
It's very sort of primeval, tapping into that sort of, I think, deep psyche about storytelling. After all, that's what ideas about utopia are. They come from stories. People imagining the future, imagining a better place.
Sakira,
Although it's a great show and there's loads of good music and stuff like that, there's also a sort of a message there. It's a lot of fun, but perhaps, like, you know, we can change things for the better.
You know, you see things in these areas that you just would never see anywhere else. It is a kind of utopia, I suppose. It's stretching the boundaries and the imagination. It's fantastical.
We are living other people's utopias. It's just we don't know it. And it's just because our utopia is in the future. I mean, I talk to people about the welfare state being a utopian experiment, and they go, what? I go, yeah, but you bring somebody from 100 years in the past, walk them through a hospital today, they would think this is utopia.
Utopia what? Never heard of it. Where, is that somewhere in Luton?
Recycle by dying. The less of us, the more for us. Make space for your fellow citizens.
You can make the mountains ring or make the angels cry.
Shangri-La, Arcadia, Unfairground. I can appreciate what they're doing, it's just not right next to where we are. They're the sort of stunt that ought to be out in the middle of the desert, a la Mad Max, not at Glastonbury Festival.
We preserve our grass up here. Look, we've got green, green grass to sit on. See a brown mud down there, isn't it?
I just got annoyed with them when they got louder at 4:30 in the morning. I wasn't entirely sure why that was necessary.
I just cannot take the noise. It does something to me, that terrible, terrible noise. Do, 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 do. 3 days of that, and I just actually want to kill somebody.
If something was to happen in there now and somebody screamed, I wouldn't hear it. If somebody slips or somebody's annoying somebody else.
We would love to feel that we're in tune with the rhythms of the planet, movement of the seasons, and work with it rather than expending huge amounts of money into some mega spectacular. I think that audience are youngsters who really just want to get out of it on a very temporary level, whereas we're more into it as a future lifestyle.
The Greenfield has inspired us. I think that we're as inspired by them as they seem to be quite positive about us, you know. And, you know, at the moment we haven't quite got there, but we're definitely looking into ideas. If we could make this thing run off biogas, for one. For two, if we could make it run off biogas from last year's people's shit at the festival.
Or Michael's cows,
yeah.
I rate festivals on whether I'd like to live at them. The Greenfields here, I could quite happily live with most of these people all year round, but the neighbours are... I'd change to a more desirable area, I think.
Wake up,
trying to like push anything down anybody's throat. Well, not until later in the evening. It's more of just desensitizing people, I guess, and having them feel comfortable in a setting that has really unconventional activities. The key, I think, for what we're trying to accomplish here with Block 9 and Shangri-La and everything is just having people have that out-of-body experience. I can see the looks and the emotions on their face and the expressions are just very, like, I didn't know this about myself.
Whoever you are, whatever you do, it's a moment to get dressed up. Live life as though you're free.
One moment, please. I'm sorry for the breakaway, but I have just seen some ladies semi-naked. Hola. Hola. And why for you, you come to Glastonbury? What is
why are we here? We work for Fairy Love, which is a stall selling kind of, you know, lots of crazy dress-ups, and we grant wishes.
Is it like a hippie?
Well, kind of, but we're all about kind of self-expression and just, you know, people having fun.
Making you feel good about yourself and spreading lots of love.
So I can come for to your store and buy some clothes.
Yeah, and we'll fit you up. And
definitely.
You feel amazing.
And then I look like a true hippie.
You can be anything you want to be.
Yeah.
Anything.
You guys are fantastic.
Oh, thank you.
And Glastonbury is what you are about.
Yeah.
I can't look anymore. please.
Have a good time.
Thank you. Ciao.
I have to justify in my head that it's right, because I couldn't do it if I thought it was wrong.
Oh my God. Oh, I'm torn.
You're torn.
I'm a bit torn.
Sometimes I get frightened. It's 4 a.m. I wake up and I get moral dilemmas about where I am and why I'm doing and what I'm doing. I wake up and I think, but no, I'm okay because we built 150 water wells, you know, in Gambia last year, and things we're doing in Kenya. We're giving all this money to charity to help people less fortunate in the world. So by 4:30, I'm all right again because I think, oh, well, I'm doing all these things. It can't all be bad, you know. I mean, we have to give away €2 million, I reckon, to make it worthwhile.
Michael Eavis and the Methodism is interesting because you've got that with the Diggers as well. I mean, they are driven by their sort of Christian belief, which is not church-bound. Often it's inspired people to set up their own little enclaves where they can live out what they think the Christian way of life should be.
And most of Methodist saying is the ultimate non-conformism. We go against the trends of the establishment. We've always been kicking against the traces, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
As this is the ultimate non-conformist show.
I find I was a bit unruly in my kind of chapel, but Elvis would have appreciated my attempt to convert those fucking hippies stoned out of their minds on their mind-altering new drugs like DMT, ketamine, and MDMA. There is a major crisis in the orthodox religions of this planet. Whatever kind of deity they believe in or they don't believe in, I'm here to tell you, mothers and sisters, Elvis the Divine is the one true deity that's going to come from this angle and is going to sort us all out, right?
Hallelujah!
Thank you.
years ago, the hippies were saying everything that's going on now, they were trying to tell people about, you know, the global warming they were trying to tell people about. And no one listened because they were like, you know, they looked like, you know, beards with everybody with food in it, and, you know, they peep-toed sandals, and no one wanted to listen to them, but they were right. You know, later on, everyone's realised that they were actually talking the truth.
Going to survive? Is this the future? Are we going to manage to survive the potential climate crisis, the potential energy crisis, the financial crash that is still going on? I mean, we were supposed to have got through it. It's still here. As we party, are we partying at the end of the world, or is this a new future? It's just a shadow. This is about how do you survive in the fringes of society when the sort of mainstream idea of utopia, the consumerist utopia, is either not within your reach or that you have actually rejected it. You've dropped out.
We come to exterminate the consuming forces of this planet. The greed and money.
I do everything creative out of recycled materials, found objects. You can do everything with everything that's thrown away. This definitely is our world.
Other worlds are possibility. And this is a very place to get inspiration. Make the world how you like the world.
Put your hand here. Fantastic. You enjoy the pleasure little? Yes,
me.
Where you stay? In a tent, on the floor, up a tree?
In a bush.
In a bush?
Yeah.
You're staying in a bush? With your, oh my goodness, with your mother, your father?
My mother, just over there.
You let this poor man stay in a bush, like a monkey. Okay, Glastonbury for you is fantastic, no?
Amazing.
The music,
yeah.
And for to dance.
Yeah, I recommend.
It's good to be wise.
Taken out of school at 10 on an educational trip and brought to Glastonbury and given a tenner and an army sleeping bag on sort of Thursday and told, you know, come back here if you want us, but, you know, go and explore. And it was just phenomenal. It completely blew my mind in so many different ways. My horizons just wrapped all the way around as far as I could see. I saw it as almost like an alternative society.
For young people, it actually teaches them how to live without all the paraphernalia that they're surrounded with in the modern world. You can't get through on the telephone, so they've got to learn to do life without a mobile phone connection again. You know, there's not easy access to the internet either. They connect with people more. They learn that, oh, it's okay to talk to strangers. Strangers can actually be really fun to talk to.
Enjoy yourself.
It's a kind of raw form of education because they're teaching themselves.
Enjoy yourself while you're still in the pink. The years go by as quickly as you wink. Enjoy yourself.
Ah, senor.
Hello.
It's Harley Davidson.
Hank. Hank, nice to meet you.
Hola. Estoy con un tío que se llama Hank. Y tiene t-shirt de Harley Davidson.
See these? I paint these.
This man is so fantastic artist. He has time to paint Glastonbury beans.
With my crew.
Because all this project, Glastonbury could not help. Not happen. without a lot of people, no?
That's right.
A lot of work. A lot of work.
And a lot of love.
Sí, amor también. And amor is not always money.
No. It's not money.
It's true.
Friendship.
So many people, this man included, Hank, he's been painting the beans to make them look beautiful for the festival.
An army of people on site. There is an army of crew, from the people that paint the bins to the people that clean out the toilets, the people that build our venues, the people that come in and cook our crew food. There's an absolute army of people.
I think everybody's into it for the right reasons. Nobody's doing it for the money particularly. Nobody wants to be famous or anything like that. Everybody wants to make something really good.
I just do it because I've always loved it. I love the metal, I love just the chaos of it and the art, the partying and the, you know, the entertainment and just, yeah, the free spirit of it, you know. Don't pay the bills, but it's a complete labour of love, absolutely.
We need it, our spirit needs it. We are this, so suppose that's the way of our life. Keep doing things more wild and keep working hard with ourselves. I have to go, keep going.
Respect people wanting to excel, you know, and to do something unusual and something different and something bold and imaginative. It's not really about money, it's about passion.
Michael Eavis is prepared to stick his neck on the line and let people do creative things. He really wants us to just push the boat as far out as we possibly can. He encourages us to do it. He wants it to be as out there as it could possibly be.
The structure of that, it came from the cranes of Southampton Docks. And they come down to me and say, look, can we get a load of old cranes? Could you give us 20 grand? OK, I'll give them 20 grand, they're going to buy this stuff. OK, they come back and build it. And they turn that into that, you see, and we're on the same page.
I've been 6 months doing this.
No.
It didn't happen in the last 5 minutes.
I got a call, you know, from a Cane Hill Locks, offering me all these lock gates, a 12 by 12, all covered in barnacles. From the lock gate idea, and Stephen Barney's got a boring idea, I kind of took it over from him a little bit.
I've done something different
to what they had in mind. But,
yeah, altogether it's
a big team.
It's a big team
effort.
It's a
collaboration.
Big team effort.
Yeah. Altogether.
Heads together.
It does work, yeah. But all those factors, I was getting emails and things saying, oh, we don't like this, we don't like that. But in the end, do you know what? I didn't read one of them.
Unique, so crazy. All these places is not just a dance stage. Yes, they are wild. Let's go. Yeah.
That's how we do it.
The 4 nights that people are here are really interesting. I think the Thursday and Friday, you can tell people are not that used to living with each other, and there's a bit more attitude and a bit more boisterous kind of behaviour. And then as the weekend kind of progresses, people kind of gel together as a kind of a mass, and by Sunday you've got some incredible energy. It's very, very hard to tell the difference between people. And even your clothes are covered in mud for a start, so you can't really tell how people's dressed. But all those preconceptions of who you are, where you fit in, and all that sort of thing, pretty much all levelled out. Really appealing about coming somewhere for a few days and yeah, completely losing yourself within it and losing yourself with other people that you didn't know before and making new relationships and having new experiences together and then taking that back out into the world and hopefully some positivity coming as a result of it.
We're all on the same side here, we're all on the same level. Would you feel that?
Oh, very much.
Well, yeah.
That's what's important for people.
I say we've got they people camping up there. There's posh tents up there. See those posh tents?
Yeah.
Yeah, they've got rollers and they've got damers and all that up there. They actually pay my neighbour to be looked after in real style. You know, Rolling Stones children and that sort of people, you know what I mean? They're all up there on top of the hill there. And when they come down here, though, we're all the same, basically. That's a great leveller, isn't it? I mean, they're all enjoying the same thing.
I think it's a marvellous example of social cohesion. We're in the rain, we're in the mud, you know, we're struggling, we're queuing up for things. But those things happen in normal life, don't they? But people don't get angry here. You don't see a single fight, do you? There's no aggravation, there's no greed, there's no anger, there's no jealousy. I mean, maybe they fall out with girls and find prettier girls or something. I mean, that's nothing to do with me, because there are a lot of pretty girls around.
People come and they get a thrill, a shock, you know what I mean? And they see something different, you know what I mean? And they don't know what it is. I was so inspired, you know what I mean? I changed my life. I saw ideas for doing things that I never would have thought I could do. I saw that ordinary people like me could do amazing stuff. It wasn't about TV and having millions of pounds, just about having an imagination and an energy. Do you know what I'm saying? I saw that, that totally changed my life. Saying something about people's able to be free and not have to be trapped into work they don't want to do, you know, money problems they don't want to have. They don't have to be just consumers, just, you know, watching telly and going to work. They could create something of that scale. That's what it is to me, inspiration, do you know what I mean, and hope.
Outside at the moment is you've got a group of very, very greedy people, an elite group, that don't care about the common person.
I think our government is completely screwing our own country by screwing both our elderly generations and our young generations. You know, I do a lot of work with youths, and their opportunities are just falling by the wayside by the day. It's terrifying. I think they're absolutely insane. I have no idea what they're envisaging for our future.
There's so many smoke screens and distractions that stop the everyday person from actually seeing it for what it is, that we're being controlled by people that just want power. We're being ruled by greed, and that's a very sad and dangerous thing that's happening.
We came out of the Thatcher years and you were either for the system or you're against the system.
I
I think personally a bit of recession, a bit of poverty might make people more awake, because I think people have been really asleep for the last 20 years. And, you know, they've been living these virtual dreams and they've been spending virtual money and expecting anything to be done for them. And I think they actually get better quality of life out of a bit of poverty and a bit of having to do things and look after each other, you know.
Involved, but I think a lot of people probably do come here and go, God, this is other slightly different way of behaving and living, and makes people think outside the box a bit. And I think if you think outside the box in one way, that can start being applied to other areas of your life.
It's a necessity in our culture to create. We need this kind of expression to let all of that oppression rip free and come alive. We're gonna make our own mad world, whatever you try and impinge on us.
There's that moment when you get back to London and you look around and nothing makes any sense. And I'm sure that's probably what this feels like to a lot of people, but when you've been here for a few days, you get this sort of tweaked perspective and it's really hard to re-enter the world. So you're like, what? Really? This? Is that enough?
Yes, there's a song that is very much associated with Glastonbury for us, which is called Common People. When we played it in 1995, I kind of made a speech, and it went something along the lines of, if you want something to happen enough, then it actually will happen. Although that sounds like a really corny kind of thing, I think it's still true. That's the whole point of it, isn't it? That anybody can do it. Not everybody will do it, but everybody's got it in them. You've got it in you. You've got it in you. You've got it in you. It's in all of us. And that's what this place is about, this festival is about. This festival is bigger than us and bigger than you. It's a feeling. It's not about me. It's not about you. It's about us.
All the way through, there are those fixed things that are common to all those people. It's the looking at the stars in wonder. It's the staring at the fire that somehow connects you with those generations in the past. There will always have been a fiddler. After the story, there will always have been a song.
Come to Glastonbury Festival, you can get a slice of life of how it could be with all the sound people running things and organising things and giving all the good stuff to people rather than all of the bullshit. Whoever's in power, whatever's going on, whenever you come here, you can always tap into that old school culture, that old school vibe that has been in this country, I think, forever, since the beginning of time. The free people, the free thinking, free minded people, are all about giving to each other. Love.
There's always someone trying to put it down, so you can't say it's utopian, but you can say that we've created our liberty is sacrosanct, and there ain't nothing that anyone else changed that.
So fly me to the moon and let me play among the stars. Let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words, oh, be true. In other words, Michael Ebis and Glastonbury,
we love you.
I do get incredibly high. But when I see things working, I mean, like they did on Saturday and Sunday night this year, I mean, that was unbelievable. I mean, you can't buy that, can you? And you can't buy it off the shelf. You can't go to the Bahamas or something and get that sort of pleasure. That's a very high level of satisfaction.
When you come into this place, you come into a different society. A society that represents total freedom. It's much better than the outside world. This is proper living. When we go back out through the gates, we're only existing.
Michael Ebis!
People that come here, you know, they go away with a different concept of social well-being, you know, and integration. It is thoroughly obvious to all of them that the social experience here does actually work. When they walk out from here, they're all smiling. People enjoy being together and living together, having fun together. And so it's a marvelous example of how the rest of the world could get on so much better by what we do here. It's just getting better and better and better. As long as I'm fit and well and able, as long as I can enjoy it like I do now, you know, there's no stopping me, really.
Later.